Hello, everybody. Welcome out. Nice to see you on this northern New Mexico batshit crazy meteorological afternoon evenings. I couldn't quite believe what was going on. I looked outside, it was snowing and it was sunny. So thanks, of course, as ever, to the Lensic, this beautiful facility. It's always nice to have our events. And thanks to all of our supporters. And tonight we're going to do things slightly differently. We'll have a conversation between these two friends here, and I'll do a brief introduction. Just relate this. The reason they're here is because we have an event at the Santa Fe Institute this week on the calculated economy. And it's organized actually by Henry and Cosmo Shalizi, who's ill, unfortunately. And when we heard that Henry and Francis were coming, we just immediately kidnapped them for the event. And I couldn't quite believe it. I thought, is it the same Francis Spufford, or is that another one, a sort of a theorist?
There is only one, I'm afraid.
There's only one. So, so this idea the idea behind this meeting is very interesting. It's that, why do large planned economies fail? Did they fail because they failed this sort of von Mises Hayek test? They didn't have the market to gather the knowledge or generate new knowledge to solve allocation problems. And in this new world of large language models and AI, maybe it would be possible to have a planned economy. And most people, rightly, are skeptical, I think, about that. But it's worth just reflecting on the fact that the large tech companies, you know, so the acronym FANG, which seems very appropriate, right? Facebook, Amazon, Apple, etc., their combined market cap is the GDP of Italy or France, twice Spain, six times Denmark, right? So we have huge planned economies that live in the free market. And so it's an interesting debate. And so that's what they're going to talk about, these kinds of topics, and I'll just introduce them quickly. So, it's probably in the notes. So, here is Henry Farrell, and he's professor of international affairs at Hopkins, and he's author most recently with Abraham Newman of a book that I've been reading just before this lecture, actually, called Underground Empire: How America Weaponized the World Economy. And the author, Kim Stanley Robinson, described this book as a CT scan of recent world history. And Francis is an author, both fiction and nonfiction, including On Golden Hill, which is a fantastic novel, actually, which won the Costa Book Award and the Ondaatje Prize. Also Red Plenty, which you can buy outside and have signed, which was in part the inspiration for this whole event. And most recently, his novel, Cahokia Jazz, which I have not read, and one reviewer described it as intoxicating as a swig of bathtub gin. So I have no idea what that means. You can explain
it. It's a prohibition joke, I think. Okay. I don't think it's as smooth as very good gin, but it kind of gets you drunk quickly.
Yeah. I'll turn it over to you two. Yes. Great.
Good evening. Good evening. And so I believe we are supposed to begin with brief introductory statements.
Okay. I shall go first. I shall go first by explaining why it says, "Comrades, let's optimize" on the marquee at the front of the theater. It's because, genuinely, in the early 1960s, the Central Statistical Mathematical Institute in Moscow had a banner in the lobby which said in big letters, "Comrades, let's optimize." And the reason they had that banner up is because, although the Soviet Union, a horrible society in most respects, although it had industrialized using brute force and technologies no more complex than a card index, there had been a recognition when Stalin was dead and they had got to the 1950s and 60s that they would need something a lot more subtle to do the next stage of their of their competition with the Western world, which, let's remember, at the time, many people thought they had a good chance of winning. They certainly did as well. And Khrushchev, a true believer and not a cautious man, had very rashly promised that by 1980, the Soviet Union would have achieved universal prosperity, full communism, and a standard of living considerably higher than the highest standards of living of the Western world. One of the problems with remembering communism now is that we have this extremely austere picture of it as something all to do with slogans and flags and suffering and self-sacrifice. But their mental picture of themselves was of people who were ratcheting their way on a one-way trip towards towards a golden future of prosperity, and they realized in the 50s and 60s that they needed considerably subtler ways of planning their economy, and they happened to have a genuine and authentic mathematical genius, a man called Leonid Vitalievich Kantorovich, the only Soviet citizen ever to win a Nobel Prize for economics. Someone in this auditorium is already thinking, there is no Nobel Prize for economics. I know that. I'm just cutting to the chase, all right? And Kantorovich had independently invented what we in the West call linear programming, which they hoped would provide a way for a planned economy where the prices were all set by administration from the center, could nevertheless become responsive enough and efficient enough and allocate its investment capital cunningly enough that it could outproduce the complicated and disorganized lands of capitalism. As we know, it didn't work out like that. But the story is more interesting than we think it is because there was some real and solid thinking in it. In fact, there were so many reasons why mathematical economics, which is what they called it in the Soviet Union, didn't work out, that it scarcely really got tried. And so, oddly enough, one of the inheritances of that big, grey, tyrannical country is a continuing open question about whether or not it is in fact possible, comrades, to optimize using non-market means. I wrote about this in my book Red Plenty more than 10 years ago, but my interest in the subject was not exhausted by writing the book, which is why I have been up the hill at the Santa Fe Institute for the last couple of days, in a room full of computer scientists and social scientists and political scientists and other interested parties, chewing over the question about whether the changes in technology since the fall of the Soviet Union, which is a technological, it's a geological age ago in terms of computing power, whether that has made a difference and whether this is once again a live question. At this point, I need to go dum, dum, dum to create suspense and hand over to Henry.
Okay. Well, I'm delighted to have the chance here to talk with you. And as you say, this novel was one of the major inspirations, I think, behind this workshop and behind a lot of the people who came to this workshop who have taken this novel and have been thinking about it and applying it in all sorts of odd, and I suspect from your perspective when you wrote it, entirely unexpected directions. It has taken fruit, it's borne fruit, and very strange and interesting fruit that might not necessarily have been anticipated when you planted the seed. But the first thing that I want to say and to make absolutely clear to everybody here, this is a novel. It is a beautifully written and quite compelling novel, but it is a novel that does something that I think is utterly odd for novels, that novels by and large don't intend to do. It is a novel, as you say, about this socialist calculation debate, which is not exactly a topic that is going to send readers in droves. I'm sort of thrilled and excited at the topic of car chases, I'm sort of languorous kisses, sudden twists and turns, but you manage to provide actually a lot of twists and turns which might not be expected. So I think on the one hand, it's a novel about a system. It's a novel about this complicated economic system that comes into being. It's also a novel about the stories that spring up around that system and also the stories that you use to explain that system. So in a certain sense, you depict these various economists, planners, Khrushchev himself, ordinary people, as seeing themselves as almost being caught up in a fairy tale where they see this world, this magical world, which is always beckoning, always just out of reach, of extraordinary plenty, a cornucopia where everything that they want, all of these material wants that they have, these privations that they have suffered, they're going to disappear. The grim tooth marks of necessity, one of these wonderful phrases that you coin, are going to be rubbed away magically by the beauty and the splendor of mathematics.
Yes.
And the other thing, the final thing that I think you do extraordinarily well, is that this is a novel which actually has people in it. Yes, a novel of a system that sounds terrible, but a novel that uses people's real stories to provide a kaleidoscope of glimpses into how the system comes into being, how it briefly seems to be flowering, and how it effectively withers on the vine. And why I think that this is important is because the system, as you say, is something that is still debated today. So we are having these debates at the moment about whether or not some of these plans, some of these tools that people wanted to use could be replaced by better tools now that we have, as David said, we have machine learning, large language models, all of these odd, strange fruit that have also blossomed more or less unexpected from the capitalist system. And we also have an extraordinary variety of problems, of huge, vast, complex, inimical systems which seem to be grinding us down, which seem to be producing climate change, which seem to be producing migration of sorts that is going to have all sorts of disruptive consequences. We have the breakdown of systems of democracy. Political scientists like myself not having any very, very good sense of how to explain this or how to even think about this, let alone how to address the problems that are created. And so I think, and this is something that I want to talk about more, we need to figure out ways in which we can bring together these systems and the people who need to understand how these systems work, and we need to figure out new stories that are perhaps a little bit more accurate than the glorious fairy tales that have brought people along in Red Plenty, to really begin to figure this out. So I think that this is what Red Plenty and the debate that is engendered does. And so I suppose at this point, after having delivered my somewhat pompous little address, I will turn to the questions and answers, because of course conversation is much, much better than hearing people talk at you. And so the first question I have is, you wrote that effectively when you started to think about writing this novel, it was a challenge. You took on the most spectacularly boring topic that anybody could imagine, and in the belief, in the justified belief, as it turned out, that you could bring this topic to life. So all of these hours spent poring through Soviet production statistics turned into a story. So how did you decide to do this in the first place? Why is it that this was a topic, apart from its innate difficulty, that seemed to be a topic to you that was worthy of talking about?
Right. The short answer may just be that I have a perverse desire to force apparently boring stories to reveal their secret interesting side. But there is more to it than that. It wasn't originally going to be a novel. I had imagined writing it in the first place just as a piece of narrative history. And then I realized that the interest of the ideas, maybe this is true about all ideas, is their effect on lives. And that particularly when ideas were as abstract seeming and, you know, unpromising as this, what would what would show their nature and reveal why they mattered would be to track them and the promise they seemed to have and the wreckage that they sometimes left behind through a bunch of real lives. And I realized that what I needed was to create a kind of model Soviet Union, a toy Soviet Union on the page, with a population of people that the reader could get to know and to care about and to find surprisingly familiar. Because one of the odd things that looking at Soviet history taught me was that alien and forbidding though it was in some ways, if you look beneath the surface, it was the kind of the weird cousin of the 20th century we'd had, with many of the same themes. In a funny way, the explicit political language, people calling each other comrade, disguises the fact that it's a story about managers finding that systems wouldn't behave themselves properly, a kind of gigantic Dilbert story in Soviet terms. And I wanted my kind of microcosm of the Soviet Union. And I wanted to show that when it comes to economics, planned economics as well as the kind we're more familiar with, you get a different kind of story. You get links between people which are not just the kind of immediate links of kind of human friendship and marriages and knowledge and falling in love, but all of the long links by which kind of effects and consequences move around in an economy. This is just as true of our economies as it was for the Soviet one. And I thought you could tell a story that followed chains of cause and effect around through different lives, and it would be a bit confusing to begin with, but it would gradually pick up momentum and make sense. And before you knew it, our innate human capacity for sympathy would carry us understandingly into some places that we hadn't expected to go. Does that answer that, do you think, or is there
more? It does.
Yeah.
And I think one of the, you know, there are several wonderful moments in the book. One moment, for example, where you have these theoreticians excitedly discussing how it is that they're going to raise the price of meat, because this is going to create all of these wonderful consequences in supply and demand. It translates into a riot in a grim factory town, which is put down by the protesters being shot based on a real event. And then you look at how the various events that cascade from this, they really flow through this series of links, these parallel links. But the other thing that I think is really interesting, and I would love to find out a little bit more from you, is, so this is, the Santa Fe Institute is the host of this, and of course the Santa Fe Institute is devoted to the study and the understanding, and to some extent the depiction in reasonably understandable terms of complexity.
Yeah.
And so one of the things that you do in this is you use a variety of narrative tricks to convey complexity, not simply at the level of the economy, but going up and down. So that, for example, you have at the beginning, you have this description of all of these beautifully well-behaved electrons in a very primitive Soviet computer, happily hopping from one place to another as they're supposed. And then at the end, as a kind of a companion piece to this, you discuss a cancer. So you have this this old gentleman who has been discussed earlier, who is an inveterate smoker, and describing the ways in which the pathogens from the tobacco, you know, so they have a million or a billion to one chance to penetrate through, and then talking about the specific mechanisms of the DNA in the cell and DNA reproduction, and how finally one of the carcinogens actually makes it through and causes the zipping and the unzipping to proceed in ways that lead to the individual's death. And these are clearly, they are metaphors, but they're a particular kind of metaphor for how the system works. So I would love to know how, where you got these, how you developed them, and also I want to make a confession to everybody here, which is that for my own work, which is my own book with Abe Newman, which is a non-fiction book, which is also about complex systems in the global economy, I tried to steal as many of these tricks blatantly and unashamedly as I possibly could.
Henry, that's okay, because I stole many of the tricks in the first place from Kim Stanley Robinson's novel Red Mars. You'll notice a similarity between Red Mars and Red Plenty. Here's the thing. The novel is itself a technology. It was invented in the 18th century, and its usual tricks are that it's very good at kind of getting close up to people, doing point of view and rendering ordinary time, our usual daily experience of things ticking past a second at a time. And it's good at zooming in on ordinary everyday stuff that matters to us. And for most of the history of the novel, that's meant kind of private life. Endless novels about happy marriages, unhappy marriages, in Tolstoy's case, both at the same time. He was ambitious. But those limits are conventional. There are ways in which the technology, quote marks, of the novel can be used to pay attention to things other than individual human subjects and things on scales other than the ordinary human everyday perception of time. So I knew that as well as the zooming out that the novel was going to do, that it was going to try and track a whole economy changing, it also needed to zoom in past the human scale and then on down. And the reason I particularly want to do it with both the extreme close-up of the radio valve-driven computer and then, alas, of the developing lung cancer of the designer of that computer, was that those are points at which tiny complexities have macro effects, that the controlled flow of electrons through logic gates builds up from something deterministic, yes, no, on, off, binary, into extremely complicated simulations of what we can ask computers to do. And the computer in question that I was doing the zoom into was attempting to calculate shadow prices for potato production, which was one of the experiments they made with mathematical economics, the idea being that you come up with a market-like logic without a market that would tell you how many potatoes to grow and where to transport them to. One of the classic early complexity problems. And by the time you got to that bit in the book, you would know that the information that these extremely clever scientists were drawing on for their potato simulation was hopelessly flawed, that part of the problem was that their cleverness was up in the air and not actually grounded in the working of the real Soviet economy and its potato fields at all. So what you'd see is something beautifully deliberate and under human control from these flows of electrons generating an extremely elaborate mistake. You'd see determinism producing basically gobbledygook, but without people knowing that. And then when poor Lebedev, who designed the computer, is getting lung cancer later, I wanted to show not a deterministic process, but a probabilistic process in which every inhaled mouthful of tobacco smoke would repeatedly roll the dice and eventually overcome each layer of his body's defenses against lung cancer, so that you'd start with something extremely probabilistic and difficult to simulate, and you'd see it ending with the extremely binary conclusion of, does he have cancer or doesn't he have cancer? Yes, alas, he does. So I wanted ways of putting on the page two kinds of process which usually we would think of as being abstract and detached from human experience, but which tie it down to potato growing and tie it down to kind of can he breathe, declare that they matter, because the world does run on complex systems. And although novels are not the usual tool for reflecting on the complexities of complex systems, they can be turned in that direction if you really, really want to.
So one of the complex systems that the book is about in a odd and backhanded kind of way is, of course, the complex system of Western capitalism. So you already discussed the way in which the book provides a kind of distorted mirror of the 20th century. And part of that is this very strange one-way love affair that you depict between the Soviet Union and the United States, where the Soviet Union is more or less, we said we'd beat you on your own terms, why don't you love us?
Exactly. Poor Khrushchev. He arrives at the White House and goes, soon we'll be richer than you. Why aren't you pleased?
Yeah. And also, you are writing this at the time of, in a sense, the peak of a certain model of capitalism. So you're writing this right before the financial crash happens.
Yep. That's so, an important piece of kind of intellectual location here. I wrote it when there still appeared to be no model that was worth thinking about at all, but the market economy and the particular vulnerabilities to do with subprime mortgages and the global financial crisis had not yet quite declared themselves. But there is a tricky little piece of intellectual history here, which is that the attempts to mathematize the Soviet economy depended on, in a roundabout way, depended on neoclassical capitalist economics, and in particular on general equilibrium models. What they were trying to simulate by early computer was a process that at this point many capitalist economists were declaring was how capitalism worked. In fact, there seems every reason to believe that that's not how capitalism works at all, and never has done. But it means that it's not just a kind of, it's not a piece of poetic license when I talk about the systems, the two systems as being cousins of each other. They are both places in which people are attempting to thrive by following a model which possibly does not accurately represent at all the basis on which everybody is living and making a living. And I wanted the book to be telling a story with more than a historical application. Apart from the fact that you can recognize yourself in the Soviet love of burgers, ketchup, roller coasters, and other American imports they took to with a real passion. They were unsure about old Europe, but America, they thought, America really got it. And they would have liked to be loved back had they not been threatening you with thermonuclear warheads. Perhaps you'd have loved them more. Sorry, I got slightly lost in embroidery there. It's not just the affinities for roller coasters and things. It's that in both cases there is an intellectual problem to do with confusing formalization for actual practice, confusing map for territory, confusing what looks like complicated enough elaborations to capture real complexity, but in fact maybe pointing you in completely the wrong direction, which probably brings us to the question about whether technology has now changed sufficiently for us to do better at capturing real world complexity.
And I was indeed thinking as you were speaking that you were providing me with the perfect lead into that, which is, so the book ends, and this is again an interesting accident of timing, by thanking Mr. Google and all of the ways in which Google search and the vast multitudes of pieces of information that it reveals create a world that you suggest is profoundly different than the world of Red Plenty. So you're effectively, you declare that we are in a new world, which is quite different from the old world. Of course, in the intervening decade, we have discovered something rather different, which is we have discovered it's comrade Mark Zuckerberg, it's comrade Sergey Brin, it's comrade Larry Page, it's comrade Jeff Bezos.
Also the People's Republic of Walmart, as that book described it.
Precisely.
Where a huge planned economy thrives inside the market system.
All of this is comrades, let's optimize. So when you look at the algorithms which run huge chunks of the world economy and of the United States economy and run our lives, these algorithms have much of the same optimizing logic as the much cruder versions of linear programming that were used to sort of calculate potatoes and whatever. And so I think there are two interesting questions for me. One is, to what extent are comrade Zuckerberg and all of these people, are they the theoreticians up high in their castles, not particularly noticing how it is that these calculations are going to change the world around them? And the other is that these calculations are much more deeply embedded into the warp and woof of our everyday lives, even than the calculations of the Soviet economists. Everything that we do when we use a computer, more or less, or the internet, is run through these optimizing algorithms. And so in a certain sense, the problem is not just that the map doesn't reflect the territory accurately. The map is devouring the territory.
Yes.
And this is a very different world. And I'd love to hear how you're...
Yeah. What I was noticing when I said that Google had made it possible to write the book is that I had gone... I am old enough to remember the Soviet Union as an apparently permanent fact of planetary life, and it was very odd watching something that was apparently kind of made of solid lead suddenly float away into the sky like a balloon. And that was an age of extremely scarce and controlled information, particularly in the Soviet context. So being able to get kind Mr. Google to deliver me all the translations that the CIA had helpfully made of Russian economic documents was great. And while I was looking at similarities, I did think the world had become definitively different. But Henry is right. We have moved on again from there. And this too is now an economy algorithmically governed and perhaps soon AI governed in a way that people were not really thinking about 10 years ago. And this too, as with any system that goes kind of all in on a particular vision of how prosperity is to be obtained, is going to have some unintended consequences and is going to make it really matter which things fall within the optimizing algorithms and which things fall outside them. Market economies too have considerable blind spots, and over the last few years we've started to see some of those showing up vividly. The ones to do with not pricing the externalities that lead to climate change, for example. Or, you'll go.
Okay, well, I'm going to build on something that you said there, blind spots of markets. And this reminds me of an essay that you wrote around the time that you're writing Red Plenty, which was called Idols of the Marketplace. And I read this essay as doing a couple of things. So it's taking this Francis Bacon phrase of idols of the marketplace, which is talking about commonplaces which are untrue, and suggesting that the marketplace that we have we idolize the marketplace in ways that really do not reflect the fact that the marketplace is a fundamentally inhuman process in a certain sense. And also, and this is something which is also quite important to you, you're a committed Christian, and there's a certain hint there that we are in fact committing a certain kind of idolatry when we think about the market as being almost a benign and benevolent deity dispensing of sort of dispensing good and evil and sort of on the on the deserving and the undeserving as they ought to. But it then finishes with this very evocative phrase that you get from the Book of Psalms, talking about idols and they have mouths but they speak not, and eyes but they see not. And so you've just spoken about how markets have blind spots.
Yeah.
But the other part of this that I think has really taken on a very different connotation now, a decade later, is we now have large language models which are...
They speak.
And they are like markets in that they are they are bundles of statistical vectors, weighted vectors, and they are not human, but they seem to talk. So what kinds of consequences does this have for our ability to understand and to use these new technologies when they actually seem, unlike markets, they talk back to you?
Yeah. And yet, what they say to us, at least so far, is largely a probability-driven digest of everything we've already said to each other, which can be useful because, as Henry himself has written, that's almost the definition of an information retrieval system. Large language models are social technologies. They are ways to get the common knowledge of our species, or at least those bits of it that are machine readable, talking back to us and providing what we've thought in extremely accessible form. I'm afraid I probably stand by the argument about idolatry. Given that, you still can't attribute to even the most eloquent large language model really the characteristics of either reason or freedom or a merciful providence. They don't work like that. But there is a real power there, and that kind of new organization of intelligence, might it be able to let us come up with non-market ways of organizing our affairs for our mutual benefit? I'm afraid that the workshop up the hill came up with a resounding maybe. But we can probably get a bit more detailed than that.
I think there, and one thing I should say is that what I've written on this is partly with Cosmas Chalitzi, who has already been mentioned, and also we are, again, I'm sort of leaning very heavily on the work of Alison Gopnik, who writes about these as cultural technologies, and is somebody who's also very often to be found up the hill from this theater. But yes, I think the real question that we have, and it was very interesting, I thought, what we came to in the end, we were discussing cybernetics in particular, and a book that has just come out, yet another book by Daniel Davies called The Unaccountability Machine, as well as other mathematical cybernetics people who were there. And the cybernetics, of course, was one of the animating ideas in a particular form of this whole Soviet approach that you described. They get very excited by cybernetics.
Yep.
And so then the question, I think where we ended up, the resounding maybe was around cybernetics does not provide a path to the land of plenty, but it does provide a way in which we can begin to talk about some of the opportunities and some of the problems. And
possibly a useful common language to describe what organizations do in a way that would give us more of a handle on arranging organizations to do things that we need to do. The classic argument for the planned economy back in the 20th century was that it would allow human beings collectively to choose our future, that it could be directed. There's a lot of extremely kind of denigrating metaphors for markets back in those days. People talked about them groping blindly around because they had no explicit direction. It turns out to be the case that actually the 20th century version of the planned economy couldn't be very well steered either, except towards a kind of cancerous development of more and more heavy industry. Nevertheless, it remains an important point, and we really need tools that would let us choose more aspects of our collective fate. We could do with being able to steer deliberately the way we inhabit our environment, for example. We could do with being able to discover non-intuitive efficiencies in the way we use raw materials. We could do with finding the best ways to use the decentralizing and decentralized qualities of the new technologies. One of the things which Comrade Kantorovich back in the 1960s was most excited about is that he worked out that that you could take coercion out of the Soviet system. If you simply came up with a mathematically perfect set of plans, then you wouldn't have to tell anybody what to do, that you'd simply send them out to kind of to make as many rubles as possible producing, and you would magically get the exact selection of goods required to achieve the plan. That is to assume that a society is going to decide on one objective function, as it was called, one thing to be maximized or minimized or optimized, least, most, best. I think as inhabitants of plural democracies, we're going to be inherently suspicious of the idea that we ought to have one objective function. But we could probably use the tools of democratic governance, if we're lucky, to decide on a few objectives which are kind of necessary to our thriving and survival. And it would be great if we could find ways of steering the ship of economics, in part, not in a way that sends us all down the salt mines, but in a way that would use our ability to gather information and our ability to process information in a way that would save us from our own myopia. That's a statement of faith of a sort.
So steering the ship of economics, and that's a pregnant metaphor, because cybernetics comes from the word Kubernetes, which is the word steersman. For steersman or a helmsman. And so but one of the helmsmen that we need, I think, we need fiction and we need novels. So you said a little while ago in the conversation that we don't usually think of novels as being tools for addressing the complexities of the world, but that they can be, and that one of the things that you've done and other people like, indeed, Kim Stanley Robinson have done is to try to do this. What can novelists do to reveal the complexities of the world in ways that make them more tangible and also more less terrifyingly bleak and alien?
Yeah.
What are the things that you can do that a scientist or a social scientist or any of the other people who tend to hang around in places like SFI, what can you do that they can't?
Right. Okay, to answer that question without sounding kind of madly vainglorious, I have to start off by acknowledging all the things that they can do that a novel can't.
Precisely, yeah.
Novels can't quantify. Novels are very good at allowing complex causes to register through the miracle that is irony. But you don't get to say what the relative proportions of all of those different causes are. You just go, heavens, there's a lot of stuff in play. There are things which novels just can't do. On the other hand, what they can do is they can illuminate the consequences of ideas. The basic and fundamental magic of the novel, which is that it can get us out of the bone prison of our own individual skulls and show us temporarily what it's like being other people, can be extended. And it can send that sense of human presence and human readiness to sense from another vantage point much further away into the intricacies of systems, into the way that future people may be dealing with the far end of the chain of decisions that we're making now. That's what one of the things that science fiction does. It can show us angles of vision which don't correspond to any particular individual pair of human eyes, but which nevertheless show us something vital without which our understanding will be incomplete. And it can make us care. It can show us the human stakes of even the most apparently abstract seeming proposition. They're almost always are human stakes in really abstract seeming propositions. When we open it for questions, someone is going to give me an abstract proposition I can't see any human stakes in. But as of now, I feel 100% certain about this.
So I think we are now at the stage of the conversation where it is possible for people from the audience to ask questions. How exactly that knows? That works, no. I don't know. But
can we bring up the house lights so we can actually see if anyone...
Yeah.
We could see you at all. Great.
And we'll be shopping with mics around.
Ah,
wonderful.
Okay.
So if anyone has a question, in the back...
Yeah, I'd like to sort of take off on the title of your talk. That's Comrades, What Should We Atomize?
Yes. Yeah, pick your indicator. There is an extremely well-known tendency for any system to deform around whatever target you care to specify. To be Soviet about it, if you target the production of pig iron, then huge areas of human welfare will be neglected just to produce pig iron. On the other hand, we need to be numerical from time to time. Possibly we should be suspicious of the idea of optimizing, which has a value judgment built into it inherently. Maximizing and minimizing are merely numerical, more, less. But best is a value judgment. Best for what? Best for whom? There are likely to be trade-offs concealed in any particular target we optimize.
So I'd go maybe a little bit further and say that even the mathematical part of optimization, it is a two-edged sword. And you can see this in the last 20 years of Silicon Valley. Mm. It's a story about very, very intelligent people taking problems which do not appear to be optimization problems and figuring out ways in which they can be turned into. And you can think about this with regard to the algorithms that run social media, the algorithms that allow us to search for things. All of these are, in a certain sense, they are the product of really wonderful engineering, figuring out how to optimize and turn stuff that looks like it shouldn't be optimizable into relatively well-behaved problems. But, and here's a but that I think Francis was referring to earlier, there are things that can't be optimized. When we have different value judgments, when we fundamentally disagree as humans, and we are a pretty quarrelsome and argumentative race, which has good and bad things, you cannot optimize across fundamentally different value systems, which don't even agree on a sort of on how to measure, let alone which should be measured as being more worthy or less worthy. And so this means that politics and all of the problems and questions that come with politics really don't fit into an optimizing mindset. And so you see, you've seen in the past people like, say, for example, Brin, one of the co-founders of Google, more or less saying, why do we have all this partisanship? Why don't the intelligent people on both sides just come together and come up with a concord, which is a wonderful idea, but which is not going to happen. And then more recently, I think we've had people begin to think, well, let's just optimize around my values as the CEO or as the sort of the god leader of this particular micro.
I don't know who you could possibly be referring to that. But
the sad truth is that you actually probably don't. There are too many candidates.
Yeah.
But optimization is a wonderful, extraordinary tool. But and this is another way in which the lesson of the Soviet Union, when it goes too far, when it doesn't have pushback, it can lead to terrible results.
Or when you fall in love with the power of your own tool, so that and you get really good at coaxing a range of human situations towards those in which you can apply the tool. There is an enormous danger of magical thinking. There is an edge you can fall over without noticing, in which you start to believe that your tool is of universal application, and that more things can be optimized than actually can, and also that your own powers are quasi magical too. Because if you can solve that family of problems, then surely the other stuff must be easy as well. If we have inherently and irreducibly plural goals, then we can't optimize the really important stuff.
Yeah, and what we want, and this is a classical account both from the right, classical liberals, and the left, what we want to do is figure out ways in which we can live in peace with our different values as best as we possibly can, and manage our disagreements so that they, they never disappear, but so that they do not overwhelm us.
Yeah. Aided perhaps by a healthy pessimism that tells us that our democracies are not ideal systems producing the most efficient possible outcome. They are good enough ways of resolving clashing stories of the world without us putting our hands around each other's throats. That they are ways for us to come to peaceful settlements between colliding ideas. That's pretty good, actually. I mean, that's not nothing. And in the long run of human history, that's a remarkable achievement that's worth keeping.
Yes. There's a question back.
There's a hand over here as well.
Do you have some comments on China, which sort of went from completely planned to some form of savage capitalism and is now reverting back to much more of a planned situation?
I realized that the Chinese story was a whole different one. One of the things that fascinated me writing Red Plenty was that in the last Gorbachev phase of the Soviet Union, he never appears to have considered the Chinese option, which is, in short, to keep the Leninist political system and bring in market capitalism to handle the economy. Instead of which, Gorbachev appears to have been a genuine, old-fashioned socialist idealist who thought that you could liberalize and democratize the political system while keeping the planned economy. Had he been merely self-interested or enough of a pessimist, he would have done what Deng Xiaoping did in China, and there would probably still be a Soviet Union now. What is happening now in China, other people can interpret far better than me. We've been talking about this over the last couple of days, among many other things. There are
some areas of genuine Chinese technological brilliance where they are at the present technological frontier. There are areas of huge and growing inefficiency in the Chinese economy which are not necessarily addressable with the political system they've got and the tools they've got. And I have no idea what's going to happen.
Well, one of the other people at the workshop is Dan Wang, who has another book that I will recommend to you, except that you can't read it yet because it is still in the process of being written. And it is exactly on the way in which China is an engineer state. Just as the United States is a country which is built on lawyers, built on this notion that we have a constitution and this is awesome, and you throw a stone in the House of Representatives or the Senate, if you hit less than four or five lawyers, I'm sure it'll be a very poorly aimed stone indeed. But China is a country of engineers, and so this has consequences for the way that the country works. So that, for example, people are promoted based upon whether or not they hit specific numeric targets. This, of course, introduces a lot of problems in the system. Statistics tend sometimes to be rather loose and loose in directions which favor the interests of local officials, which want it to appear as if their economies are doing very well. It also means that you might be more inclined, for example, to encourage a building boom of buildings in your province, which turn out not to be particularly useful. But by the time that all of those glorious growth statistics have evaporated, you will have moved on to some other job far higher up in the system, and dealing with the outcome will be somebody else's problem. So in a sense, you get a world, you don't want to overgeneralize too much. And I should stress, I myself am not a China expert. I read and I try to absorb. But you get a system in which numeric targets play some of the same role that other aspects, legal aspects of the federal system play in the United States in terms of controlling the relationship between localities and the national level of politics.
Dan Wang's book will be called Imperial Wages and will be published by Penguin. I think it's worth pointing out, and Henry has done so, that the apparently forbidding and intimidating apparatuses of social control that have been devised using information technology in China have enormous problems of informational quality, and the more controlling the system is, the harder it is for them to verify that the information that is being sucked into their grand systems of social control is any good, because they produce incentives to game the system, to game the system in proportion to how socially powerful it is. So tyranny's not very good at getting dispassionate information inflows.
And there's a wonderful recent piece of research by a postdoctoral student at University of College Los Angeles, which makes a lot of the standard narratives in the United States much more complicated. Because there's a story that you often see, which is that the Chinese authoritarian state is going to be vastly strengthened by these new forms of artificial intelligence, which will allow for far more effective propaganda, far more effective surveillance. And there are ways, of course, in which AI makes surveillance easier, but there are also ways in which it turns out not to be nearly as useful as you might think. So this extraordinarily enterprising young academic managed somehow to get his hands on one of the artificial intelligence models that a Chinese social media company uses to impose state censorship. And this then allowed him to play around with it and to find out, was it actually any good at doing what it was supposed to do, which is predicting social unrest? And it turns out to be not very good at all, because because China is not a free country, people don't actually say what they think, so it's very, very hard to measure for indices of sentiments that might say that the government is in trouble and the people are getting angry. And so what Yang suggests that they have to do, they actually have to turn to Chinese language sources outside of China, to grumpy dissidents using Twitter and similar, in order to try and figure out how to train their models to predict what happens. So you find that the information problems go all the way down.
Yep. There is a feedback problem in authoritarian societies, in which they have as much need to get a reliable sense of popular opinion, which they are busy repressing, and the more they repress it, the greater the incentive to lie, and the more they are operating blind in relation to their own people. I should point out that there is a weird similarity between present-day alarm about the technological achievements of authoritarian China and Sputnik-era alarm about the intimidating technological achievements of authoritarian USSR. It is very odd reading the early 60s Western press and the panic over things like the far greater number of engineering PhDs produced in the Soviet Union. The engineering PhD gap was something that the Kennedy administration worried about quite a lot.
Well, I think we are literally 5 seconds past our time, which I call, I'm Irish, I call that sort of spectacular punctuality by Irish standards. So I think we probably should take our leave.
I think we probably should. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.